5 years from now, the power of this motherboard will be stored on your smartphone. No? Okay, at least your laptop then. Hey everyone, this is Mukul from MuBot Industries. I mean, just this channel, there is no industry per se. So I actually bought this motherboard even before I could actually purchase the Ryzen 3900X. I was pretty confident with the overview which Bill Zoid provided on his video, claiming that the VRMs on this motherboard are pretty darn good for the price they are offering. So I've been using this motherboard for 2 weeks now, and I wanted to share my experience with it, the features this motherboard provides, and the temperatures at which this motherboard worked when I was doing this Prime 95 stress test. Even when the CPU temperature touched 115 degrees Celsius, the system turned off, but the motherboard was able to successfully maintain a healthy temperature on it. More on this in the video ahead. When I choose a motherboard, I make sure that it is quite efficient in managing heat on it. If a motherboard is offering good VRMs, good capacitors, decent enough heatsink for my requirement, I'll be more than happy with it. I'm not a serious overclocker or anything, but I just wanted to make sure the motherboard I am buying stays efficient, stays cool, can maintain higher peaks in the temperature, even if I'm using auto overclocking with the processor. I have been using the ASUS TUF series motherboard since my first AMD processor purchase, which was FX8350. So after using them for 5 to 6 years, that motherboard is still performing as good as it was on the first day. So that alone screams the kind of quality ASUS puts in their TUF series motherboards. And it was just a coincidence that when I was looking at the current X570 series offerings on the market, ASUS was among one of the first ones to offer a decent motherboard, a good motherboard with excellent VRMs on it. Motherboard. I have done a lot of 3D and video renderings on my ancient gen AMD's FX8350 processor, and I am hoping that this motherboard is as durable as the previous one. So I kind of wanted the best VRMs on my motherboard for the auto overclocking I'll be doing with the processor. But by best, I don't mean that they burn your pockets, burn your bank accounts, burn your bitcoins if you have any, or burn whatever you own which you can claim is your financial health or wealth. I think you get the point. So in India, naturally, if a motherboard in US cost around $190-$200, the same motherboard is costing here around $230-$240. I got this motherboard for around 17,000 Indian rupees, and I think this much investment is fair when you plan to use your motherboard for many years. And this is why I made sure to not expand my budget of buying a motherboard, because as I've already claimed, I'm not going to overclock the hell out of it or anything. So I just wanted to make sure that my overclocking temperatures are always sustained on the motherboard. So the other motherboard which comes near to it is the Gigabyte Aorus X570 motherboard, and it's not a bad motherboard or anything, but this motherboard in this same price segment is offering you a little better VRMs on it. So I went with the ASUS, as simple as that. There is no confusion, I hope. I think I made my point clear. I think I should proceed with the video now. So for starters, this motherboard supports the Ryzen 3000 series right out of the box, and hence they are called X570. It can also support some second and first gen Ryzen processors, but I think the list is kind of constrained when it comes to supporting the first and second gen Ryzen processors. So make sure you know which processor you have and if the E series of motherboards are going to support them or not. But I wonder who would want to put their old gen Ryzen processors on the latest motherboard which is there in the market and spend more, unless and until you really want that M2 PCIe 4 support on the motherboard. But it's not like as if you buy a M2 Gen 4 drive, it is going to be twice as faster than the M2 Gen 3 drives. There is a performance boost between these two drives, the Gen 3 and the Gen 4, but it's not worth upgrading your motherboard just for that. Maybe in a year or two, the difference between these two drives, these two generations, will increase significantly, and maybe then it would make sense to get a motherboard or upgrade a motherboard if you are really focused on upgrading your storage drive speeds on the system. So by TUF, T-U-F, ASUS means that military grade components have been used on the motherboard. So in times of a warfare crisis, you know what kind of weapon you are going to use first from your home to attack the enemies. I personally did like the design of the motherboard overall. I also like the heatsink design, but of course this is totally subjective. Overall, black themed motherboard will suit your black themed case if you have one. They do say the heatsink is validated for 60,000 hours plus, which is like almost 7 years, so whoa. But I hope the motherboard will also stick to what ASUS is claiming, as the warranty of the motherboard is just 3 years. So the motherboard clearly got no time for that. So if I put my brain in calculating how many hours there are in 3 years, so that would mean after 26,280 hours you would have no support. Yeah, I definitely used a calculator for that. The ASUS TUF series has made this collaboration with other companies as their so-called TUF Gaming Alliance. So for gamers who only know how to install and play games, it becomes easier to vet all components to get if they have that kind of serious fandom for the ASUS TUF boards. So go TUF boys or girls. The LAN on the motherboard is Realtek and not Intel. For me, Realtek has performed good so far in these past few years. I've used it on my last ASUS TUF motherboard, so I don't have any issue with that. ASUS has this Turbo LAN utility which lets you allot different speeds to different programs you use. A sweet utility if you want to invest your time to these kind of things. The board comes with ample amount of USB ports on the back and on the front. There are 3 USB 3.2 Gen 2 1.2, there are 3 USB 3.2 Gen 2 ports on the back, with one of it being a Type-C port. Sadly, my case doesn't support Gen 2 USB-C on the front, so I'm going to use an extension to get help with that. But wait, I also don't have a device which wants the USB-C port. So no worries, I will see you in few months Type-C port. Then there are 6 USB 3.1 Gen 1 ports, with 2 of them at the midboard, which means it can be connected on your front panel. And then there are 4 more USB 2.0 ports at midboard. So in all, a total of 13 USB ports on your motherboard, which is pretty darn good if you have a huge family of USB devices lying in your home. The board supports up to a whooping 4400 MHz overclock DDR4 RAM speeds. I wonder why these companies still haven't started using GHz on defining RAM speeds. It won't be bad if I say 4.4 GHz instead of 4400 MHz. If any of you out there know why they are doing this, let me know, because clearly I couldn't Google it so far myself. But I personally bought the 3200 MHz or 3.2 GHz RAM for myself because I am not crazily rich, and that's why I'm doing YouTube now. This board can also support up to 128GB of RAM with 32GB in each DRAM slot. And as soon as Google Chrome heard this, it went crazy in joy, consuming terabytes of more RAM throughout the globe. The audio supported by the board is Realtek S1220A8 channel. Or I could have said Realtek 8 channel. There are separate PCB layers for both left and right channels, which is quite good and interesting. There's also an SPDIF output for audio files. The board comes with an array of light which mildly lights even if you have shut down your computer, but the computer is still connected to the power source. These turn off only when I switch off my UPS too. But it does look kinda nice seeing these small array of lights mildly lighting a pitch dark room until you switch off your UPS. There's a display and HDMI port on the back panel too, to be used with integrated graphics, some of the Ryzen processor support. There are 2 PCIe 4.0 x16 slots on the board. There is no mention of SLI, but it does say 2-way Crossfire X. But I personally always prefer a single GPU solution on these type of motherboards. If you do connect 2 Radeon graphics cards on the system using these 2 slots, then one of them will be running at x16 and the other would at x4. I remember a few years back, there used to be motherboards in the same price segments which used to come with 3 PCI Express slots on them. And at least 2 of these slots always ran at X8 bandwidth. So clearly, inflation has struck us hard. So because Nvidia's SLI at least needs a X8 lane for its graphic processor unit to run, they are not feasible on this motherboard. The VRM on the board utilizes 12+2 Dr. MOS power stages, which is known to be a reliable VRM. The board has 6 layers of PCB on it. There are 2 M.2 slots on the board, and it comes with a heatsink for one of the M.2 slots. The size of VRM heatsink is decent enough for this price segment. Updating the BIOS is a breeze. You just restart the BIOS with LAN connectivity and let it download and update the BIOS instantly without any of the hassle of copying stuff from USB drive to the BIOS. It also comes with ASUS crash-free BIOS 3 so that you can somehow recover a corrupted BIOS update. And there are debug LEDs, which are known as QLED, on these ASUS boards. In total, there are 8 SATA ports on the board, and there are a lot of other I/O ports which I would suggest you to read on their website. But I do believe that this motherboard doesn't have a BIOS flashback feature on it, so you would always need a processor pinned to the motherboard to update it with any kind of BIOS updates. But do correct me if I'm wrong. For RGB lovers and accidental RGB lovers like me, there is one addressable Gen 2 RGB header on the board and two 4-pin RGB headers. A RGB header helps you control lighting on your system, and ASUS Aura Lighting comes with a variety of options to play with it. Let me know in the comments if you want me to make a video on it. The layout of the motherboard felt really spacious. The only confusion which I had when I was assembling the system was the 8+6 pin power connectors on the board, and with the help of a friend and Reddit, I was able to understand why it is not necessary to bother about the other 6 pin slot. It is advised to be usable only when you do serious competitive overclocking. And because I don't like competitions, I was never going to do that. So I was told to be not bothered about that, even if I tried to do some sort of overclocking on it. And auto overclocking is not going to be an issue. The processor is never going to demand that much of a power from the power supply. The only drawback I could find with the motherboard was that the board fan completely hit below my RTX 2070 Super. I'm also going to put a review of that. So imagining the fan being hit completely under the GPU, it kinda increases my paranoia, but I never noticed any kind of fluctuations in temperatures due to this on the board, even when I ran the Prime 95 stress test for almost 20 minutes. The temperatures of the board sustained around 48 degrees to 49 degrees Celsius, which is quite good considering that during the Prime 95 test, my processor reached to a 150 degrees Celsius temperature and the system shut off just to keep it safe, and the motherboard temperatures were fine. They were around 48 to 49 degrees Celsius. I wanted to add that my room temperature at that time was 25 to 26 degrees Celsius. So seeing that kind of temperatures during a stress test, it always pleases my mind and it always keeps it at peace, because saying peace of mind was shorter than this. So anyway, I was really impressed with how the motherboard dealt with these temperatures during the stress test, and that's why I'm pretty happy with my decision of buying the motherboard. Listening to BuildZoid analysis, and I totally agree with him. The VRMs on this motherboard are damn good for their price. The other tiny gripe I had with this motherboard is that the lock of the PCI Express slot where your primary graphic processor unit will go in is kinda stiff, and especially after putting the 2070 Super on the motherboard, it was really hard to release that lock and make the graphic processor unit pop out easily. So I really had to spend some minutes figuring this out, and it seems like if you have good flexible tiny fingers, then you won't have a problem. Otherwise, it is going to be really hard to pull big graphic cards out of this motherboard. And that is not what she said. Hardware Unbox recently compared this board against similarly priced Gigabyte MSI ASRock boards, and this one fared the best. So basically, I have no qualms with the motherboard except for the placement of its fan. But if you're using a mini sized or a smaller size graphic processor unit, then you won't have a problem with even that, because my earlier 1060 GTX Amp Edition was placed completely fine on the motherboard. So if you are going for 2060 or 2060 Super, I don't think the fan will be an issue. And it's not an issue, but it's just a concern which I had to share because that's what I experienced. And sharing experiences is good. So I'm loving my processor being ran on this motherboard, and I will love it till I die. Or the motherboard dies. Especially after the warranty period dies. So do leave a like if you like my efforts on this video. Dislike if you dislike the video. But I hope you like the video. That's all for today. MuBot out.